Okay, so so last day we sort of finished the proof of diffusing along a finite number of resonances. Of course, I completely skipped all the part of the with shadowing, which is variational. I mean, it's long and technical, but it needs a lot of language and a lot of definitions to explain it. So I'm going to skip it. And today I'm going to talk about Arnold diffusion along infinitely many resonances. So first, let me recall the result, which I state on the second lecture. So as always, recall that we are working with h of phi I t, which has first some h0 plus epsilon h1 phi I t. And here, phi belongs to two torus. I belongs to some b in R2, and t on the torus. And as always, I assume that h0 is strictly convex. So Hessian is positive definite everywhere. And h1 is CR. OK, so what I explain in this second lecture is first that we have a KM theorem for this kind of Hamiltonian. So let me first fix notation. D eta tau is the set of frequencies in R2, so that omega comma 1, and this one comes as always for time, times k, sorry, it's bigger or equal than eta over k 2 plus tau for all k in Z3 minus 0. So for me, eta and tau are both positive, and they are going to be both rather small, as you will see in a moment. So this is the set of different frequencies with constants eta and tau. And then if I can define, so since the actions are in B, if I can define B prime just as the image of the frequency map through B. And here, recall that the frequency is just the I derivative of H0, and this is a global diffeo, because H0 is fully convex. So I have a projection between actions and frequencies. Then the KEM theorem we're going to use, which in this CR version, it's partial for the autonomous case and Solomon's gender for the non-autonomous case, is that fix eta and tau, fix the regularity bigger or equal than here is, so here, 4 plus 2 tau plus 2, and assume that h1 has CR norm below 1, and that h0 is real analytic. This assumption is sort of, I mean, it should be removed, but it's impartial, so then there exists epsilon 0, which only depends on eta tau and h0, and t0, which only depends on h0 and r, so that for all epsilon between 0 and epsilon 0, and for each frequency belonging to this, which is defined in the in B prime, in the frequency space, then H0 plus flourish one has an invariant or I. Torai T omega with dynamics conjugated with dynamics conjugated to a rigid rotation, conjugated to phi equal to omega, right? Conjugated to a rigid rotation. And then if call KJM of eta to the union of this torai for every omega in these sets, then we have that the Lebesgue measure of this torai, of the set of this torai, over the Lebesgue measure of our phase space, it's bigger or equal than 1 minus C0 eta. For, KEM is for any eta, even of order of square root of epsilon. Here we use the version of a fixed eta because it's what we were going to be using in the to diffuse. So then this is the stability part, then the theorem. By Kaloshin and myself, is that in the same setting, but now taking R bigger or equal than some R0, which we don't know yet, but it's going to be large, then, and again, I mean, eta and tau positive, and then there exists a then set of H1 in SR, which we call that this Hamiltonian H1 with CR norm equal to 1. So a then set D inside this SR, so that for every H1 here, an epsilon small enough, then H0 plus epsilon H1 has an orbit satisfying that that it accumulates it accumulates to the set of KM torai, meaning that if we take the closure of this orbit, it contains all these KM torai. So before going to giving a sketch of the, I mean, some ideas about the proof, let me make some remarks. First, as I explained, I mean, it's also true in the photonomous case of 3 degrees of freedom, but only in the region, say, where the derivative of H0 with respect to I3 is bigger than some eta, which means basically that it's true as long as we have one variable, which is time, basically, so it's not saying much more than what I've said. Second, that it should work, this proof, also for eta of order epsilon to some power, but we haven't tried this yet, but I mean, at least for some very large power, it should be true. With a very small power, it should be true, meaning that then the absolute, I mean, the relative measure tends to 1 when the parameter tends to 0, as happens for KEM. The optimal should be here, square root is, I'm sure we don't know how to do it, but different power, which should be true. Then, let me say here that it's important that we get CR density. And this, I'm going to come back to this later. So the density is in the same topology as we are taking for the regularity. Here, since we need to approach KEM to array, we will be using higher and higher resonances, which means involving higher and higher harmonics. For higher harmonics, if you get density with less regularity, means basically it's changing completely your Hamiltonian. So if here, I mean, having here, say, CR bonus kappa density, this should be, let's say, I mean, not easy, but it's much easier, meaning that for very high harmonics, to modify it with low regularity means changing completely your Hamiltonian. So you can basically add whatever you want. You can add penduli everywhere to get diffusion. To have chair density, it's much harder, and it's one of the pains of this proof to stay in the same regularity. Okay, so let me give some ideas of how we prove this. So what we want to construct is a net of resonances, which certainly is going to be infinite. So we want a net of resonant segments. Which obviously is connected. We want to jump from one to the other, and tends to diaphantine frequencies, meaning that the diaphantine frequencies belong to the closure of these resonances. So recall that all in the result that I've explained this last 2 days, called in Zhang, we can get raw density, so raw dense unstable orbits, meaning that we can construct orbit that if we take a raw neighborhood of this orbit, it contains the whole phase space. So if I draw here frequency space omega 1, omega 2, say I can just take all vertical and horizontal lines of distance, let's say rho halves, and then if I can diffuse along all of them, so if I get that part of the neighborhood of the orbit contains all the action space or all frequency space. So here now, what we want is that if we have this rho dense set of resonances, here I'll have some diaphantine frequency. And I'll want to have some segments which depart from this rho dense net to approach each diaphantine frequency, right? So here, let's say there are two steps. First, let's try to do it for one frequency and then for all of them. I mean, here, of course, the number of frequencies, the set of frequencies has positive measure, so it's kind of not obvious how to do for all of them. So first, let's just try to approach one frequency. One frequency omega in here, and then I'll explain how to do it for all of them. So, as you all know, to get vectors, these segments close to a diaphantine number, the usual tool will be the Dirichlet theorem to approximate any vector. So here, what do we get? We will take a sequence of Rn, which will be radius in radii in Fourier space. And then what's telling the Dirichlet theorem is that there exists some Kn in Z3, satisfying that Kn is below Rn, such that omega star times kn is below or equal to rn to the minus 2, right? I mean, that's the usual Tischler theorem. And this is basically measuring how, I mean, that we are getting closer and closer to the Fantine number, right? So this would be the first approach, but it does have a problem, is that here we can get, so the problem is that we can get consecutive vectors, kn and kn plus 1, almost parallel. So something like this, right? So this has two problems. First, that if here, I mean, if this was very close to omega, and now they are very parallel, they can be intersecting much farther away than I mean, we want to look this in this neighborhood. So this is, say, this is kn, and this is kn plus 1, and they are in the neighborhood. But now they can be intersecting very far away, and then it's very hard to control. And then that's the problem one. And then the problem two is that being almost parallel means that kn, say, minus kn plus 1, should be much smaller than kn and kn plus 1, right? Which means that we can have this picture and then here have an extremely strong resonance crossing the same point. Which means that it's very easy to construct the cylinder, but there's no way that we can construct these two. What's happened for the single resonant case that I explained, if one is much stronger than the others, this has cylinders. It's not even clear that they two have cylinders crossing this point, okay? So we cannot use just Dirichlet, but there are some non-homogeneous versions of Dirichlet theorem. Which can be used to impose that the angles are always uniformly bounded, which means the following means that again, so if I fix some omega in the eta t, then there exists a sequence kn, which it's almost Dirichlet, meaning that omega star times kn, which should be Rn power minus 2. Now it's going to be Rn power minus 2 plus 2 tau. So we lose slightly. But here for us, tau is going to be something very small, so we actually don't lose much. And then that the angle between kn and kn plus 1, it's bounded uniformly, say, by pi over 6, by 30 degrees. I mean, you can just prescribe a lower bound. Of course, here, just by being Diophantine, here we have also this, right? I mean, it's so with this theorem, we get an extremely precise knowledge of upper and lower bounds for the distance of these of the resonance to the Diophantine point, right? So here now, the distance from omega star to gamma kn is just omega star times kn over kn, right? Which means that this is just 1 over rn3 minus 2 tau, and we call this rho n, which is the tested neighborhoods in frequency space, which are going to be measuring how we're approaching Diophantine frequency. So rn pgm Fourier space, it's in our choice of, so this is, I mean, this is in Fourier space Z3, are the radius that mean which harmonic we are taking. This is, rho n is in frequency space. And of course, so here we have the Diophantine omega star. We have this set of size rho n. We actually have, so here, gamma kn. And actually, we also have a So we have an proper bound for this distance and also a lower bound. So it's extremely precise. Okay, so this was just for one frequency. Now we want to do it for all of them at the same time. So first, it's clear that we don't need to do it for all of them, but just for a dense subset of frequencies, right? So actually, what we will do is not just do this, but to get an increasing a number of frequencies in bigger and bigger sets, and then to include them at each step. So to approximate all frequencies. So first, so we have these raw ends that I've just defined. Which are the radius, the radii in frequency space. And then we will use what is called the Vitali covering lemma, which says the following, that from any finite cover of this different frequencies by rho n balls of radius rho n, then there exists a subsection, sorry, a subcover or a subcollection of balls such that the balls of radius 3 times rho n still cover the whole set of diffusion frequencies, and the set of rho n balls, and rho n balls are disjoint. So here, of course, the problem is that getting many and more frequencies passing through the same point. So we want kind of control of how many can cross at each point. So this is giving us a way of having some sort of separation of between frequencies. So then, of course, I take balls which are centered at frequencies which are diophantine. That's the ones that I want to be approaching. So then, I denote the d eta to n, the centers of the balls of these subcollections. Okay, let me take it out. So, of course, these sets are finite, but so obviously this d and eta are finite. They have an increasing number of points as we reduce the radius, and the union of this d eta to closure contain the whole set of diophantine numbers, right? So at each step, so here we have steps, a numbered n, each one for each radius. But each step we are will be approaching a higher and higher number of diophantine frequencies, okay? So to do this, we define what are called the, so fix omega star in one of these generations, in the nth generation. Then we define the Voronoi cell of omega star at the nth generation as all points in frequency space in B prime closer to omega star than to any other point in the same generation than any other. So let me make a picture. So these white points are, so white means n generation. So here we have the Fresnel cell for each point, which are the points closer to each one than the others. Obviously, then here we know that this is contained in the ball of radius 3 rho n, thanks to Vitali, and it contains the ball of radius rho n. And these balls are disjoint. So what we will want is to have one resonance crossing each of these cells, right? So this is going to be some gamma k. So for the cell of omega star gamma k n, and then if green is the n plus one generation, then here I have a much higher number of points, because I'm taking smaller radius. I'm going to take again these Fresnel cells, whatever they are, for the next generation, and then I will want to depart from this gamma, from this one, to a new one, one for this cell, one for this cell, one for this cell, and so on, right? I mean, of course, they can be, the same for different cells, but so.
At the same time, so you target the parallel ones.
Yes. Exactly.
And then you, from there, identify the other frequency, and then you produce the, so you refine the resonance net.
Exactly, exactly.
So it's reducing time.
As a tree. So, I mean, in generation for a Voronoi cell, I have just one resonance. Then in this same Voronoi cell, I mean, here now, it will contain many Voronoi cells of the n plus one generation, right? Here there are many of them. So here I have just one for this generation. Then here I'm going to have basically rho n power minus tau, or a large number of lines for the next one. And they are, it's going to be take a tree. From this one, you have all these branches departing. And then for this one, in 10 plus 2, there are going to be much branches here departing, and so on. Okay.
Sorry, but I think that you must perform a variational argument to get the order.
Yeah, right.
But the limit step is the same, or is?
I mean, here, of course, I mean, first I build this net of resonances, then I build the cylinders. Once we go to the shadowing, it is the same. So the shadowing, it's so abstract, it's only involving some equivalent relation between quasi classes. You don't know if they are finite or pre-infinite. I mean, it's the same. I mean, even for the classical lambda lemma, which is just for Primorian Torai, you can shadow a finite number or a pre-infinite number. I mean, they work completely the same. I mean, if it's finite, you get a tiny open set shadowing. If it's infinite, it's just one point typically. But it's the same. And here as well, it's just the same using Fresnel methods.
You care only about one resonance.
Yes.
But you don't want to navigate with the trajectory size. You only care about one diophantine
line. Okay. Yes.
But if you look for trajectory there outside, can you get total
measure? I mean, here you approach as much as you want to the torus. Yeah, I mean, of course, you go and go back and go and go back. Otherwise, you don't get it. But I mean, since this strategy they are fine-tuned, as long as you get close, I mean, fix like any neighborhood of any point of the torus, as long as, I mean, as you get close enough to it, you're going to cover this ball, because you spend such a long time close to this torus that you, I mean, of course, your orbit, it's never dense. It's just, I mean, dense for any, exactly. No, it's, if you are asking how is this orbit doing to get density, we don't know. I mean, the idea is that you always, I mean, you can always come back and get more density, then leave, and then come back and get even more density, as, I mean, up to infinity. But we don't know how he's behaving.
No, clear, so I say that even for one to write, it's 99%.
I think so. But I don't know if for one to write, you could construct some sort of variational proof. I mean, more building the variational problem to show that actually. In forward time, you are, I mean, this should be doable, that in forward time you approach the torus and in backward time you go away. And then you would get, like, probably full density as t tends to infinity. But definitely that's not what we get here. And with these techniques, I don't think it's, it comes from, for free. I think you need to set up, like, a variational problem to. I mean, with geometric methods, you can prescribe the order of tori that you are shadowing, but. Let me also say that with this construction of nested Bernoulli cells and this Pietali lemma, actually what you get is that gamma kn, I mean, this, the segment we want, we use of gamma kn only intersects other segments of neighboring generations. Okay, which means that we have a very good control of resonances, which is crucial to be able to construct then the cylinders. We don't want any segment to intersect other segments of a much low order. Okay, so then of course the next step is to get the existence of cylinders okay. So of course here the main issue is that to approach the Evento frequencies we cannot use epsilon as a small parameter. And the reason is clear, I also said it the other day, if we want denser orbits, then we need to take epsilon smaller, which means that if we want to tend to a different frequency, the validity of our proof using epsilon as a parameter would be zero. So this wouldn't work. So here what, so the small parameter we're gonna use is rho, okay? So since here we are very close to a different time frequency, here we have extra stability. I mean, we are very close to a KM today. And this stability, it's measured by rho, which is the distance from the defined time. So here rho, it's going to be rho 1, and then recall that the next one is going to be defined from the first one. So but this is going to be so the parameter we use. So everything needs to be uniform in rho. Okay. So to do this, obviously rho is not appearing in our Hamiltonian. So here, what we need is to recall that close to, so we have H0 plus epsilon H1, but so close to omega star defining, say we have extra stability. And as we know, this can be done, for instance, doing propagation theory. As I explained the other day, if we do propagation, we can push the angle dependence to higher order. So we can change h by change of coordinates so that I get here a new h0 of I plus a new perturbation which has a rho m in front. And here, of course, I mean, rho m sub n. I mean, we will do it in at every step, right? Of phi I t. And of course, for this here, we need regularity. Definitely, I mean, as you know, to make some steps of averaging, you need some regularity. And now here we get an extra smallness in our perturbation. That's what we're going to use to construct the cylinders approaching to the Fentane number. Actually, it's not this what they're going to use, but what is called the partial normal form, which is basically saying that this can be done at the same time for all the different frequencies. So not just for one, but for all of them at the same time. And that's important because here, of course, if we need to do this particular step of our construction, we would get rid of all regularity. So, I mean, at some point we need to stop. So we need something which is uniform and which can be done everywhere at the same time. So, where am I? The special thermal form is saying that, again, we can transform our Hamiltonian to a new integrable one plus a new perturbation. And this H1 is of order I minus e to theta tau. And this is just this set of actions with frequency diophantine. So I mean, this is a distance from a point to a set. So this is uniform, and this, I mean, this is like an outcome of this KAM Cantor sets. I mean, this is all this windy construction of that Peschel did. That, I mean, he did this for all KAM tori at the same time, and then since it's a Cantor set, you can construct a true change of coordinates, which is CR minus something, which is Whitney, I mean, which is CR Whitney in the whole phase space. So, but at the end, sorry, power n. I mean, this is what we use. At the end, it's, I mean, locally, it's completely equivalent to using this, okay? So now we can use this extra smallness to get cylinders, but here there are two problems. So I mean, there is one problem, which is that here, while doing KAM and doing this thermal form, we get some loss of regularity. So now we are, it says here minus kappa. I don't want to go into details. But still, now we will want density in CR world. So we want to here perturb things in a much smaller density than our, let's say, a natural world where we are. Okay. So here, actually, what we will do, and that's also one of the reasons why we check density in our result, I mean density in the space of perturbations, we will start with our H0 plus epsilon H1. And before applying Peschel, we will do some modification to some new Hamiltonian, which is going to be analytic. Okay, but this it's not the usual one because we want to do it not moving the KEM tori. So it's a modification which is only performed away from KEM tori. In KEM tori, basically we know how it is because I mean then we apply KEM and it's completely trivial. So we will need to do it in some again. In some sets which are tending to the KEM tori to get it analytic everywhere, but not move the KEM tori. And then from here, we will apply Peschel to get a new one, which is the one that we're going to use. Okay. This is also important because to use these precisional methods, we need a common system of coordinates to apply our operational problem. And this is going to be the good one to do it. Because here we can control the neighborhood of each KEM tori, and then we can diffuse through all of them. If we go to the original coordinates, it's very hard to know what these frequencies are doing. In this set of coordinates, it's extremely clear how you are approaching each KEM torus. Well, yes. I mean, but the typical modification you do is always through this like integrals with kernels that you get the things are analytic. I mean, this being infinity or being with a very like CR with CM with very large M would be enough. I mean, here it's not crucial that it's analytic, but it's something that you get basically for free. But I mean, of course, it's analytic. You only get good norm estimates up to CR. Definitely, for that, I mean, there's one blow up, but. Okay, so, and then for this Hamiltonian, we want to study the single resonance regime and the double resonance regime. So here again, we perform normal forms. But first, we will need to perform much more, much higher order, because then to get non-degeneracy, we will need to, we can only modify it by CR. So we need extremely small remainders here. So here we need a larger number of steps of larger number. Of normal form to have much smaller remainders, because now we will need to check these conditions that I explained yesterday in the single or in the double trans case, and this is going to be here much difficult than in the previous problem, because in Clausian Zank basically you need to check them in a system which is parameter independent. In the single resonance case, you just get one potential to which you need to check stuff, and this is a potential which is epsilon independent. And in the double resonance case, you get this mechanical system which is also parameter independent. Now, in our problem, even the choice of harmonics depends on rho. I mean, it's not that you have a rho in front; it's that your harmonic depends on rho. Thanks to your regularity, you have some decay in the Fourier coefficient, which also depends on rho, because you have very high harmonics. So it's not that you can impose some condition and say that's generic. You need to be extremely quantitative to prove that this genericity is, let's say, some power rho away from zero. I mean, you need to be, so here you have some sort, let's say, of quantitative in the non-degeneracy conditions. And that's also for the reasons that we need to make a huge step of numbers of normal form to have extremely small remainders, so that here you don't need to be extremely accurate. Because of, otherwise, basically, we don't know how to do it. Okay, but anyway, doing this, we obtain the net of cylinders, which is basically identical as the one that I explained yesterday. I mean, this is a technical stuff, but at least the idea is that with some qualifications, we again obtain the net of cylinders which approach Diophantine frequencies. Okay. And then again, putting band functions to split invariant manifolds. Plus using traditional methods, we get the diffusing, so plus variational shadowing, we obtain this orbit, which is following all these cylinders, and therefore it's accumulating to all KEM today. Okay. So it's the same construction, but a little bit more more delicate.
So, yeah. In the, enough to understand how is used the quasi normal form.
Yes.
You compare to the classical normal form. So the problem is.
So the issue is that that it's global. That it works in the whole phase space. So you have a unique change of coordinates which works.
So in the classical one, you go drive and drive.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. I mean, exactly. I mean, you could do a Birkhoff normal form close to one torus. But the but this is global, and to use precisional methods, that's much more useful. Because of course, I mean, if you do this for one Torai at the nth generation, then at the n plus one, you get much more nearby. Then what do you do? If you apply Birkhoff over Birkhoff, but then you lose more regularity, and this will lead to a disaster. Or you need to go back to the original system and I'll make Birkhoff for all of them. I mean, it's not only for precisional methods. We need to match all these frequencies, all these resonances. If we start doing changes of coordinates, it's much harder to know than that all of, I mean, which one correspond to which one in the other system of coordinates, and to prove that these cylinders are unique and that you can cross from one to the other. With this one, you first do this, then you get the rodents or set of resonances, and then with this pretty same system of coordinates, you can approach each frequency. Of course, then we do more steps of normal forms, and they are local. But then, since they are done over this, it's very, I mean, it's easier to control how this cylinders change from, from one system to the other. I mean, this phi here, obviously, it's just of size epsilon, but it's not of size rho, which means that if you want to control how these tables could change, I mean, they are changing by a lot, I mean, in terms of rho. I mean, this is of order one in rho. So it's this is very important to make our construction, because you get basically a uniform system of coordinates which works in disks tending to each of the Diophantine frequency, but also globally. So we can connect them globally and also locally. Okay, so if I have half an hour, right? Or, so in this last part, let me discuss a little bit about open problems and about how to continue with all these works. So the first thing I'd like to discuss is a higher dimension. So Arnold diffusion in higher dimension. Before I finish with this. This obviously, it's very good to approach definite infrequencies. And that's why we get positive measure of approaching OKM today. If we would like to get full density, which is a much higher, harder problem, definitely the issue is that we don't know anything about the complement. And here we have very good thermal forms, which are very, very precise to know the behavior. I mean, to go from what we've proven to full density, it's a much higher problem. And as far as I know, I mean, nobody has a clue how to prove it, I would say. Because, I mean, you don't know. I mean, definitely, it's more unstable. And there are, there are resonances. And I mean, it's because it's away from KM today. But then to know which path to follow to get full density, it's completely unclear. Yes, this yes, but this would get a measure which is fully, syntactically, as epsilon tends to zero. But for to get just a measure one.
You would like to get measure one?
Well, I mean, this would be this is the quasi-ergodic hypothesis to get measure, I mean, full measure. But this is completely far away from what we are doing. I mean, yes, this should be doable. I mean, this is a matter of going through the proof and check the eta dependence on each of the steps. And I'll do it the next month. But I mean, it's a lengthy proof and it's technical, and we haven't done this yet. But this should be true. To get full measure, it's they were saying that it's a completely different, I mean, different, much difficult problem, and that definitely with these methods, there's no way to prove it. Okay, but now, so let's go back just to Parnell diffusion, just using a finite number of resonances in higher dimensions. So far, we know for n equal to 2.5 or 3, so what happens for n bigger than 3.5, right? So what can we do? So there is something done, which is, as I said, Bernard Kaloshin Zhang, which is valid in any dimension. And what they do is they diffuse along segments of codimension to resonances, which, of course, in the case of 2.5, will be just the single ones. This means that they take these lower angles are in n. These lower angles are in tn minus 1. And then they get one fast angle plus time in T2. Which means that they get one cylinder with two angles, as I was getting for the 2.5 case. And then all the rest are slow. So let's say all the rest are hyperbolic. So let me make the picture for 3.5 systems. So if we consider the case of 3.5 degree of freedom systems, then we get that the frequency space is R3, right? I mean, the frequency is omega comma 1 which is in R4, but if we just look at the frequency space, is in R3. So here what we get is that, so planes are single resonances, right? These lines are the double ones, and these are, and this is the BKZ regime. So only one fast angle plus time. I mean, here time is hidden. And then here, obviously, we would get some points, which would be the triple resonances. And of course, what Vadimke and Patrick do is they make, these punctures away of these resonances, and they know how to diffuse between punctures. Okay, so now to get to prove Arnold conjecture, you don't need the single ones, but you definitely need the triple ones to diffuse. I mean, here you could do, go like this, then go up, and then continue like this, whatever, and you can do this without looking at single ones, but definitely you need to use the triple ones. Yes, so now for the triple ones, triple resonances, what you get is that these low angles below 2TN, right? And so this is slow angles. And then T, belonging to the one torus, is the only fast angle, right? That's what would be in triple, I mean, this would be in co-dimension one resonances, which in the case of three, for three and a half, would be these points here, would be the triple resonances. So to understand these co-dimension one resonances, again, we could do, as I explained yesterday, so do averaging plus rescaling. And then the first order would be some system, which is a mechanical system, as we had, but now phi is in the Tn, or say T3 in the case of 3.5, and I is in R3. And to study this system is much difficult, much more difficult than the case of 2 degrees of freedom. If you want to here to apply professional methods, first, being a minimizer doesn't imply being hyperbolic. I mean, the relation of being a minimizing and hyperbolic, it's much more difficult. I mean, difficult, it's unclear, I mean, and it's false in general. And then you get all these Hedlund examples that, I mean, if you want to minimize in homology classes, you get all sorts of strange behavior. I mean, in T2, for instance, if you want to minimize among 1, 0, you get an orbit. If you want to minimize among 2, 0, you just get this orbit twice. I mean, you have this kind of good structure of minimizers. Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. I mean, you get just the same structure, but then to find the ceiling, I mean, it's not clear that I mean, you definitely have some cylinders generically, but to localize them, to know that they are minimizers, it's not. Sorry? Yes, yes. Exactly. No, I think there are even counterexamples of a fully elliptic. I think so. I'm not sure, but I think that, I mean, there are all sorts of nasty systems which present all well, very strange things.
And the singularity, the same order, the same.
Well, the singularity. No, I mean, if this is an absolute minimum, then you.
Yeah,
but yeah, I mean, so this is basically, I would say, the main problem to generalize what Vadim and Kay have done to higher dimensions, to see how one can deal with these systems. Obviously,
sorry.
Yes.
You travel horizontally, vertically, whatever, but that will resonate the one that is allowing you to turn.
Yes. I mean, either to turn, or sometimes you encounter them in your path and you want to go straight.
Yeah.
But I mean, both things. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Exactly. I mean, here there is the other approach. There is try to avoid these punctures, and then try to move along planes, trying to avoid triple resonances. This should be, this could be a different approach. Then the issue is that we get our pendulum-like structure. So here in BKZ, they get like a pendulum with much more dimensions in the manifolds. In the single ones, we will get a pendulum times a cylinder with more dimensions. Yeah. And again, the problem is not the same, but it's very similar. To make the shadowing, we know how is the dynamics inside this cylinder. And we want to have minimizers here again. So if this is just that for 2D cylinder, I mean 2D, I mean in the angles, that's basically a 2D map. So your resets, I mean, you can use every matter.
Yeah, no, if you just only navigate by a simple resonance, you're going to fill the line. So there's no way to avoid the double resonance. But in principle, in 3.5,
you have freedom either to choose double and single or double and triple. You have this freedom of using one or the other. Exactly. So single. You can avoid this. In the a priori unstable case, that's what Terem Adeo and Rafa have done. That they kind of make like orbits that go, but it's pretty unstable. So in this sense, it's. No. I mean, here you have this choice of one or the other. But in both cases, there are problems of. I mean, in both cases, you need to reduce your system to a lower dimensional one. Here is this 3-degree freedom mechanical system. In the single ones, you need to reduce to the cylinder. In the 2.5 case, basically, in each of these cases, you get a 2D map or a 2-degree freedom system. In the 3.5, all of them have 2.5. And 2.5, it's just what we've proven. So, and they were close to integrable. Here, it's less clear what's happening, right? So that's the. Yes. Yeah. No, I think you don't.
Instead of being a cylinder, much complicated manifold, but it's your manifold that appears in 2.5 degrees of freedom, and then
it's
normally hyperbolic with some kind of
connector. I mean, definitely here inside, you have a near integrable system. But to make shadowing grid a very precise knowledge of the invariant sets. And that's always the pain with these problems. Okay, and then to finish, let me talk about a problem also, which is, of course, what we've done is for these quasi-residual sets of Hamiltonians, but one would like to prove diffusion in concrete examples. Meaning examples, say, coming from terrestrial mechanics, etc. So in this case, we need to verify some conditions to check that they are true, right? And we have some for the single resonance and some for the double one. For the single resonance, to the existence of the cylinder, as we said, it basically just checking some conditions on the potential. And of course, this usually it's doable. I mean, it's easier to do. Of course, the point which is delicate is the transversality of the invariant manifolds. So, and here more, I mean, typically when we say concrete examples, they are always finalitic, I mean, at least most of them. Then this transversality between invariant manifolds is exponentially small. With respect to the parameter epsilon. And that's an extremely hard problem to, like for a given system to check if invariant manifolds are transversal or not. I mean, this is, now it's more or less known for systems of two degrees of freedom. And that's, that's what I did in my thesis. But if we go to higher dimensions, it's extremely hard to prove. And basically now it's only known for sometime models, which are certainly very far away from what one encounters in typical problems. I mean, this so far it's only known for, let's say, cooked problems, for cooked toy models. This, in any case, this is an old problem, meaning, I mean, this goes back to Poincaré. I mean, this is something which has been studied for many years, even if it's still open. In the double resonance case, all these conditions that Vadim and Ke considered, they're actually very new. And as far as I know, nobody has tried to, I mean, it's not known any system which satisfies all these conditions. I mean, definitely, they are generic, so it should be true. I mean, they should be. But as far as I know, nobody has found yet one system which satisfies all these conditions. I mean, even a toy model, okay? And just to finish, let me make also some propaganda of another paper that I have done with Vadim, which is analogous of phenomena like Arnold diffusion, say instabilities, in infinite dimensions, in infinite dimensional Hamiltonian systems, say in Hamiltonian PDEs. Which is a subject that now it's drawing a lot of attention. It's of different nature than Arnold diffusion, but it still has many things in common. So the case which, I mean, basically the only case that has been studied is the cubic nonlinear Schrodinger equation. So this equation. So this equation. So and here x is in the two torus. So it's in a compact manifold. So this equation defines a flow in several F spaces in HS. Okay, so defines a classical technical systems but in a phase space of infinite dimension. And it's a Hamiltonian with respect to this functional, so gradient of u squared over 2 plus u4 over 2. And it has also an extra, a first integral, which is the L2 norm, which is called mass usually. Okay. So if we go to Fourier space, so take u, it's, so u of t, an of t, and x, we get that a equal to 0 is a critical point. I mean, of course, here u equal to 0 is a solution, which is elliptic. So a equal to 0 is an elliptic critical point. Which means that, of course, for a pretty equals to 0, this is basically a nearly integrable Hamiltonian system. I mean, this is precisely the setting where we've been working, and one would like to know the stability of this critical point, right? Meaning that if I take orbits nearby, if they stay close to it or not. So here, of course, the answer is depends, because now since we are in infinite dimensions, we have many topologies to choose. Of course, having this as a first integral means that this point is the point of stable in the L2 topology. So stable, yes, in L2. And also in H1, if we look at this energy, having fixed energy, since here there is the gradient, means that basically it's also stable in H1. And here the issue is that know that it is unstable in several F spaces for S bigger than 1. Okay? And this is called usually growth of several F norms. Okay? And here the conjecture would be and that's by Burgen, that there are orbits whose Sobolev norm tends to infinity as t tends to infinity. So even if you have a fixed energy and fixed mass, you can have a blow up in finite time. But so far, the only thing that has been proven that there exist orbits and time so that they start with norm as small as we want, and we end up with norm as large as we want. So fix mu very small and k very large. Yes. Sorry. Yes, thank you. So this is the conjecture. So far, the only thing that we've been proven is that you can attain a growth as larger as you want. So this is by a long list of people, Colliander, Staffilani, Tao, well, they call themselves the I-team. And with Vadim, what we proved is, I mean, we computed for which time this is true. So we proved that for times of this form, so for times which are almost polynomial, you can attain this this problem. Anyway, this is just to say that even if these are fully PD problems, to prove these results, what they do and what we do is to drift along resonances that you encounter close to the elliptic point, basically. And at the end is something very similar to Arnold diffusion, that you need to look for instabilities, and these instabilities gives you this growth of Shogolev norms. Yeah.
But do you transform like an ODE, an infinite dimensional ODE?
Yes. And you truncate, and you get some system of finite dimension, yeah. And then there you need to look for resonances, as we've done for finite dimensional systems. It's different, but it's in the same spirit. And then you look for these resonances to drift, around this critical point. Okay, so which is a different phenomena than Arnold diffusion, but definitely it has very much from the same flavor, the sense that we are close, to an elliptic point, so we are in a nearly integrable situation. Nevertheless, this close to zero, you have KEM tori, and this is known, but also you can have this type of instabilities. Of course, yes. Yes, of course.
In principle, the Galoshian sum theorem.
No. It's a completely different construction.
Okay.
Completely different.
But it's like a single
problem. You need to choose very carefully some set of modes which interact in an extremely resonant way. This critical point is resonant, so it's not that you are close to the affine time. You get some resonances. So you kind of get them after some work, you get them for free. You get some kind of connections between periodic orbits, which corresponds to drifting along resonances, which leads to this festival phenomena. No, this is completely different from Kaloshian Zhang, has a different origin and has a different techniques. But the phenomenon is also an instability phenomenon in a nearly integrable system.
So you go from BD to an ODE, infinite dimensional.
Yes.
So somebody knows if you perturb this infinite dimensional ODE in a certain way, then you go with a BD to an initial one. Because in dynamic we did.
No, I mean, if you perturb in the Fourier space, you get what is called a pseudo PD. Which means something like a PDE, but in Fourier space.
No, okay,
but definitely it's not a true PDE, meaning that it's local. Let's say,
PDE, you add the norm view power three. So you can perturb a PDE.
Yes, but usually.
And this will give you an ODE nearby the initial one.
Yes. Typically, if you want to make something as putting band functions in Fourier space, definitely when you go back to your to functions, it's not going to be a PDE.
Yeah.
If you modify also, for instance, the spectrum, definitely it's not going to be. Easily could not be a PDE, right? If you modify the spectrum, you can go to this fractional Laplacian, for instance, which is it's a global operator. It's not local. It depends also what you define as a PDE. You get some equation which it doesn't need to be local. Can involve other stuff. No? Okay, and I think I'll finish here.